Hi, everybody. Welcome to Cloud Cover. My name is Chris Reisner. Today, I've got my special guest, Kevin Lamb, with me today. Kevin, would you like to tell everybody about yourself?
Sure. My name is Kevin Lamb. I'm a Principal Program Manager in Windows Azure. Most recently, I've been working on the Windows Azure Scheduler, and we just released a portal version of our scheduler just last week.
Great. And today, Kevin's actually going to walk us through what that feature is and how to use it. So, Kevin, you want to get started?
Sure. So we had actually released for public preview the Azure Scheduler service about a month ago, but API only. And we were very excited last week to actually release the portal extension for the scheduler in the Windows Azure portal. When interacting with the Windows Azure Scheduler, the first thing you need to do is go enable your account for the scheduler service. So you can go to the preview features page and go ahead and enable yourself for that service.
Great, and so once that's done, I'll start seeing it in the portal.
That's right. So then once you get that done, you'll see a little tab on your left-hand side that'll show your scheduler on the left-hand side.
Great.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk through creating one of these jobs and explain some of the benefits and features that we have in the scheduler service.
Okay.
Just as a little background, the intent of the scheduler service is to provide a new platform service, not only for our customers, but for our first-party services as well. We have first-party services such as mobile services using it that's backing up their scheduled script feature.
Mm-hmm.
Guys like Skype and Xbox Video are also using it to have scheduled work that's going on in the background.
Great.
So now that we have a portal extension, what I'll do is I'll walk through some of these experiences. So first thing I'm going to do is go ahead and create a new job. So go to the bottom, add. We're under App Services, and there's a new icon for a scheduler that's in the preview mode. I'm going to go ahead and custom create one of those scheduler jobs. So at the very top, you have a job collection. A job collection is a collection of jobs that will run in a particular region.
Okay.
As we go through the demo, we'll see that there are certain properties of a job, for example, like quota, or that's where you put your free and standard plan for your jobs.
Okay.
Job collections can run in 4 data centers around the world. So they're in North and South Central US, North and West Europe, and East and Southeast Asia. One of the important things to note about picking these regions is that we're able to handle high availability for our jobs, meaning that when you create a job, you don't have to worry about if one of our data centers goes down or something goes wrong on one of those data centers, that we will continue to run that job someplace else.
Okay.
So you don't have to create an alternate job and say, data center North Central is down, I'm going to have to go and disable that one and enable one of my jobs someplace else.
So you've got some built-in redundancy for your jobs.
Yeah, built-in HA into our service.
Fantastic.
For your work.
Great stuff.
So not only for our management capability, but also for execution of your jobs.
Now, what would be my motivation for picking a specific region here?
Because the scheduler service is mostly doing invocation of endpoints, the thing that you want to think about is latency. Now, anywhere around the world, latency is for doing a request that's happening at most once a minute isn't too much of a concern.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want to have your jobs located as close as possible, you can pick the region that's closest to you.
So if I've got all my stuff in one data center, I should put my scheduled job in there too.
Sure. Now, the scheduler service doesn't run in every data center around the world, but it does run in every continental geo region.
Okay.
So if your data center is in California, does it really matter if you're in North Central or South Central US? The latency for those requests are still going to be 50, 60 milliseconds from either place.
Okay.
So it doesn't matter. And that's one of the things to note for a failover. We'll fail over and you won't realize that it's actually running in that alternate data center in the same continent, in the same geo.
Because the latency is still so close.
That's right.
Perfect.
So here I'm going to pick a region, North Central US, and I'm going to create a new job collection. And you can name this anything you want. So I'm going to say Kevin Jobs. And go ahead and click Next. So here's now where you're going to define the job action. So the job action is going to define the type of action that's going to occur for each iteration of your job. We have a couple of different job types. We have an HTTP job, an HTTPS job, or a storage queue job. For HTTP, we're going to execute one of our methods, get, put, post, delete. We actually do support more through the API, but through the portal we've exposed these for. And as long as it's reachable from HTTP, we can reach your endpoint. So that endpoint can either be in Azure, on some other cloud service, in your own custom data center, or even on-prem if you have something like Relay exposing that.
As long as it's accessible, it's fine.
That's right. As long as we can reach it, then this job can go hit it. And for storage queue, a lot of folks like to use storage queue for asynchronous processing, not only for long-running operations, but in case that they don't want to be online at the time that the request is going to come in.
Mm-hmm. Now, as far as HTTPS goes, is the only really difference there is that it's going to mandate that you have a valid certificate?
HTTPS is going to make an SSL request out to your endpoint. So it has if you choose HTTPS here, then the HTTP web request will do the appropriate work to ensure that it's a valid endpoint.
Okay.
So let's go ahead and create a simple HTTP job, and I'll call this ping bing. Do a get, and I'm going to go to bing.com. It's a very simple job.
Mm-hmm.
So the next thing you get to do is define a schedule. So the types of schedules that you can run in Scheduler are either a run once, so you can pick a time that it can run, either immediately or sometime in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can have it as a recurring, so run once now, or you do it at a specific time, and you get to pick your start time and an offset from UTC. If you want to pick a recurring job, then you have quite a few options. We can run a simple recurring job, which is every minute, hour, days, weeks, and months. We actually support months, but just not in the portal right now. In our next release, we're actually going to add months to our scheduling.
All right.
Here. So let's say we pick weeks. So I'm going to run every 2 weeks, and I can choose a particular schedule. For example, I wanted to run every 2 weeks on Monday and Tuesday. And it can start now or at a specific time. Say, I don't want this job to start till next week or next month.
Mm-hmm.
This is a particular job that's going to hit an endpoint where the service isn't ready to start doing the workload. And then it also has an end time. So I can run this till the end of the year or next year or whatever that is.
Do you have to actually put an end time? There's no just keep running
well,
forever.
Well, in the portal, we've asked everybody to put an end time. Is a lot of times people are creating jobs and not realizing what their jobs are doing.
Keep running.
For going through the API or through the REST API, you can actually create a job that runs forever.
Okay.
And we won't block that. That's actually capable. So let's just go create a simpler job and say it's every 2 minutes, and we're going to start now. So in the background, what it's doing, it's going out to the scheduler service. It's going to create that job collection, and then within that job collection, create the job. And we can see that it successfully is completed.
Very quickly.
Yep. One of our design goals for the scheduler service was to have high availability and simplicity. So when you look at your jobs, you shouldn't have to, you know, pull out your Wikipedia page to understand what a cron tab expression looks like. You should be able to read what that expression looks like, and I'll show you what that looks like in a bit through Fiddler, so you can actually see what a raw job looks like.
Great.
So if we go ahead and click on the job collection I just created, the first thing we get to is a dashboard. And so the dashboard, let me show you one that has a bunch of jobs in it already. So the dashboard shows the number of jobs that you can have in your schedule. For any job collection, we have a maximum of 50 jobs.
Mm-hmm.
The number of jobs that are that you have currently completed. Any jobs that are faulted, so we redline that if you realize that a job faulted. For example, a faulted job would happen if all the retries fail for every occurrence of your job, then we consider that job faulted.
Gotcha.
Right, that thing is just unreachable.
So if Bing was down, you know, and we kept trying to hit it, we'd get a fault.
That's right.
Gotcha.
The jobs are enabled or disabled. You want to realize that, oh, I accidentally disabled and forgot to re-enable one of my jobs. So we pop that up right away.
Mm-hmm.
As well as the number of executions. So if I've had 330 executions in the last day or so, and I purposely have 140 errors because I created some bad jobs.
Okay.
So that we could see what's happening here. We also get some quick glance information. On the right side, we see that the job collection has started, the region that it's running in, the number of errors that jobs can have within that job collection, and the occurrence faults. And we'll come back to this a little bit later when I go through Fiddler, but this is the magic URI that you can hit to actually look at your jobs
through
the REST endpoint.
Okay.
So if I go back to my jobs that I just created, the other thing we can look at is scale. So on the scale tab, this allows you to choose your plan. So there's a free plan and a standard plan. Depending on your plan choice will depend on the constraints of the jobs that you can do.
Mm-hmm.
So for a free job, you have a maximum of 5 jobs you can create, and the max frequency is 1 hour. So that's our limits for free. But for standard, you can create up to 50 jobs with the maximum frequency of 1 minute.
Okay. And now, is the maximum, is that across all your job collections or just a specific collection?
This is for this job collection that we just created.
Gotcha.
So we will make sure that for any job that you create into that job collection, that we'll maintain those constraints.
Is the same true on the free tier? So 5 for each job collection?
That's right. So for the free tier, you have a limit of 5. And if I go ahead and change that to weeks or hours, if you try to create a job that is faster than that, you'll get rejected.
Gotcha. Great.
So one of the things that we were doing here is doing forward looking into scenarios where we can start supporting RBAC. So you can have a subscription owner that will go ahead and create job collections,
mm-hmm.
Set these quotas, and then give permissions to people to create jobs within that job collection.
Okay.
So they can't go and mess with these settings, but they can be free to create jobs. Okay. And then they'll get denied if they're violating those quotas.
Makes sense.
So the next thing we can look at is the list of jobs. So I only created one job in this job collection, and it describes the last time it was run, the next time that job will run, the status, gives you an insight to the frequency of that job, and if there were any failures in the count of executions.
What happens if you change? So we've already got this job that's kind of running every 2 minutes. What mm-hmm. happens if you then go into your job collection and say you can't run it 2 minutes, you have to run it in an hour? Will there be an error there, or will the job change, or since it's already created, will it just work?
Yeah, today, because if you already created the job, we'll allow that to happen,
right.
But you can't create new jobs. With those settings.
Great.
The other interesting part that we have is history. So we can see for every execution that you have, the history of those requests. So because this is run twice so far, we can see that it's hit Bing, and we can actually look at the response from Bing. Oh, there comes another one. So we can look at that response and see that it's a bunch of Bing goop, because they show a nice picture and
sure.
some Bing stuff.
But that's actually the HTML for the
webpage.
That's
the HTML that's coming back. It's more interesting, of course, you can copy this to your clipboard, but if you go to a bad job that's failing, then you can actually see what the error code is and why it failed.
Great.
The remote, in this case, it couldn't be reached. It doesn't exist, boing.com.
Hmm.
So, I mean, at the high level, this is the whole service. One of the things I did want to note is that the capabilities in the portal don't quite match the capabilities that we have in either the REST API or our SDK that you can get from NuGet.
Mm-hmm.
But we will be adding more and more features to the portal to highlight those, to light up those capabilities as we go forward.
Great.
So one of the things I did want to show is go through a Fiddler example where you can see what it takes. So notice in the example that to create a job, I couldn't do certain settings. One of the settings that we allow you to do is to have something called an error action. An error action is creating reliability within your job, meaning we've made the promise that we will run your job no matter what. So
right.
if a data center fails, we'll have that job run someplace else.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the challenges is that if you're trying to go and reach an endpoint in your service, but that service goes down, that's not under our control, so we can't help it.
Sure.
But maybe you can. Maybe you've created an HA data center someplace else.
Mm-hmm.
For example, you could have had a data center in North Carolina. Something happened in North Carolina. A line got cut or something else that made it unreachable. You can create an error action that's actually going to point to another data center in, say, Florida. It's
mm-hmm.
going to go ahead and reach that. So
okay.
after the number of retries, we try really hard to reach that initial main action endpoint. If that continues to fail after the fifth retry, that's what we have as a default,
right.
then we will go ahead and start hitting the secondary endpoint.
And that's what you specify with this error action.
That's what you specify with this error action. So we don't have that capability shown in the portal today, but we do have that capability in the API.
Okay.
So let's go ahead and look at what that would be. So if I want to, so let's go back here actually. This is an important little piece of magic. So this is the URI to hit your job collection. So I'm going to go ahead and copy that guy and go back to my Fiddler and paste it. One little note about the way that the service management API works. With the newest resource providers, there's a notion of requests that the service management handles, the Azure RT handles, and then those requests that actually go through to the back-end resource provider and get handled. And the way they distinguish those is by adding a little tilde to their URI to let that front door know that it's actually going to be passed through to the back RP.
Okay.
So after adding that, one of the things we can do is, let's just do a get. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and get my test jobs. And when I go ahead and execute that guy, hopefully I haven't typed anything wrong, what you'll see is JSON coming back. And what's good to note is that this is very readable. This is my job collection. So this is describing the job collection. But mm-hmm. I actually want to go and get the job. So we see that we have one of our jobs. Composer. I actually got the job collection. Let's actually get the jobs underneath that job collection. That's what I intended to do.
Okay.
There we go. So now we have the list of jobs in that job collection that I created in that data center. So we could see that the job I created was, one of them was bad job. Oh, I looked at my big one. Okay. So you can see all the jobs in my test job collection,
mm-hmm.
and I have quite a few. And one of the things to note is that this thing is actually pretty easy to read.
Sure.
You're not looking at raw XML. You're actually looking at JSON. So it's a JSON object that comes back. And so, for example, you can see that the reoccurrence is every minute and runs for a maximum count of 10 times. So that's another one of those features that we've enabled in the API, but not in the portal, where you can have different exit criteria for your jobs, either a count or an end time, or run infinitely.
Okay.
You can exclude that through the API. So what I want to do now is go ahead and create a new job. So I'm going to do a put. And can I make this bigger? No. OK, so I'll have to use this little screen here. Let's create a new job. And I'm going to create a job called my HA job. And what we see here is that we have an action, which is an HTTP type. And that URI is going to reach out to boing.com. That doesn't exist, mm-hmm. so that will fail. It's just going to be a simple request with a get. You can add any headers you want. If it was a put or a post, for example, you can also add a body and put body in here.
Okay.
One of the things to note is that anything you put into this action is encrypted in the service. So anything at rest is encrypted. So you can go ahead and put secrets in here. One of the recommended ways that we have to secure a request coming from scheduled to your endpoint, your custom endpoint, is to make sure it's an HTTPS endpoint, and you can put a encrypted token in the header and then verify that it was our service that sent it to you since it's your encrypted token.
Makes sense.
And you can feel satisfied that it's not it won't be sent in the clear, it won't be stored in the clear either.
Right. Great.
So the interesting part is this new error action. So that's this part right here. And all it's saying is, if this main action fails, let's go ahead and hit this endpoint. And I've correctly called it bing.com instead of boing.com.
Mm-hmm.
And in a real-world scenario, that would have been my North Carolina data center versus my Miami data center, for
sure.
example, and hit that other endpoint. And that's it. So the error action that you can have is any action that you can define, so it's an HTTP, HTTPS, or a storage queue.
Mm-hmm.
And the two scenarios, in this case, we're talking about HA. But this could be an error management endpoint, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, notify me when something goes wrong
sure.
with my job, and then I can go and see what's happening in the portal.
Okay.
And that's it. So I've created this as a one-minute job that will occur 10 times. You can put more complex schedules here. I'll just give you a peek at what a more complex schedule looks like, but for the demo, we'll keep it simple. Do I have that here? I do. So if we look at a schedule, let's look at this guy right here. What this is showing, is that we have a monthly job that will end at the end of the year. Yes, at the end of the year. And we'll run at 8 and 5:30 on the last day, the last Friday of the month.
So you can get very, very specific about when you want these jobs.
Exactly.
Right.
So we provide a rich scheduling capability. Not all of that's exposed in the portal yet, mm-hmm. but as we continue with releases, we'll continue to expose some of these richer and richer scheduling capabilities.
Great.
Let's go back to our job here and run that job. Hopefully I haven't mistyped anything. Great, so it looks successful. So it went through. So if I go back to the portal, I created that in test jobs. I go to jobs. I should see my new HA job. Here's my new HA job. So if I go ahead and look at the history, we could see that it will have failed a few times and then succeeded. Okay, so we can see that it failed a number of times mm-hmm. and then actually completed.
So basically the first one's one is going against Boeing where that
That's
doesn't
right.
exist, and then finally
so
it goes
these are
against
Boeing,
Bing.
And then it finally goes against Bing.
Great.
So we'll try really hard to send that out, but then it will come back and hit that error action.
Great. Very cool.
So that's it.
Well, that's some really powerful stuff. And as you said, you know, very simple interface, but really a lot of capability there. And I mean, it's going to make a lot of things a lot easier, I think.
I hope so. We have a lot of people really interested in that. One of the feedback that we get from customers is that, hey, now I don't have to create some weird virtual machine that's running some schedule mm-hmm. in the background that I have to maintain, and it's not highly available, and it's a real pain in the butt. So let's go ahead and use the scheduler to go invoke my endpoint.
Fantastic. And you said that this is available, what we have in the portal today, there's the REST API, and then there's also a NuGet package?
There's also a NuGet package on GitHub.
Fantastic. Well, yeah. Three different ways you can access into the scheduled jobs, and more to come.
That's right.
Great. Well, thanks so much for coming today, Kevin. I'm sure everybody that watches is going to be really excited about what they can do with the new scheduler system.
Yeah, and if anybody has any questions, feel free to reach out to us in the forums, and we'll answer your questions as quickly as possible.
Awesome. And do you have a Twitter handle for the people, in case they want to get
a
hold of you?
I do. It's KevinLamb_MSFT.
Well, there you go. We'll put it on the screen for everybody to see, so okay. You'll be good. As always, please follow us at Cloud Cover Show and check us out on Facebook as well. Thanks again, Kevin. Great to have you here, and have a great day, everyone.
Thank you.